Erik, can you describe death and what happens right after in great detail, at least what happens for most? I mean, you know, I know everybody's experience is differently, but just give me whatever generalities you can.
Okay. I think he smoked out or something.
Uh-oh.
The giggles.
He got the giggles. He's going to go out for some ethereal nachos later.
Serious. Because he won't include me on the laughter. Like, he won't tell me why he's giggling.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know where it's coming from. To explain death in general, I think it does it a disjustice, Mom.
Mm-hmm.
So, remind all the readers right at the beginning that death is hand-tailored to the person's living belief system.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you are actively believing in, be it nothing, God, you face your demons before you have joy. You become a ghost. Whatever it is, this is what's going to be laid out for you.
Okay, then let's talk about your death. If you know your death, so let's talk about that. What were your belief systems? I never really...
God, he goes, aren't you rude?
I'm sorry. But let's talk about...
Put this down before we change, Mom. Come on.
Okay, fine.
Because people are going to ask, why is it based on your individual belief system?
Oh, okay.
And you need to let them know it's because they're the tool. The physical body, right, is the luggage. It's what contains the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
When the body dies, the spirit becomes a soul. It leaves the body.
Mm-hmm.
And that soul is then kind of contained in that consciousness, that character that you built,
mm-hmm.
all those intangibles, you know, what made you laugh. Yeah, your personality, got it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the way that it moves through these dimensions to get to heaven or home, whatever the hell you want to call it, it's got to do that through that conscious element that you set up, that belief system that you set up. That's going to be the tool to get you there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's the basis. Now, you were asking me what I believed in. I don't really fucking know. Definitely wasn't all this. I learned way more about the structures of afterlife by being here.
Well, when you pulled that trigger, did you think there was going to be nothingness? Or do you think
I was kind of hoping for it. I mean, really, I was so desperate just to get out of my skin. I was just hoping that I could... Kind of what I would imagine, Mom, like, person with a puppy or a baby, just lack of sleep, just wants that good night's sleep.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted some good, solid peace.
Yeah. But so, did you were sort of hoping there was something, or you were not even thinking about it?
Wasn't even thinking about it. I was kind of hoping there was nothing.
Did you ever think about, in your life, whether there could be something afterwards?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, because you hear, you know, those ghost stories. For me, it wasn't stories about God and miracles. What I connected more to that I thought was way more fucking believable were the ghosts. Really? That's kind of a neat way to think about it, right?
Yeah.
Because it's not like God's coming down and... The way he says it. Yeah, it's not like God's coming down to your house and fucking with your shit and knocking stuff over. No, that's the dead dude. So you know that there's life after the life you're living in, but shit, it doesn't have to be based on some religious belief system.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what...
So he said, I had an inkling that there'd be an afterlife, but I had no fucking idea what it would contain.
Okay. Now, when you pulled that trigger, what happened after that? First of all, did it hurt?
No, I don't remember any pain. I remember the sound.
Okay.
I don't remember anything touching me
after
the sound.
Okay.
So I think, I guess, you know, you get pulled from your body.
Mm-hmm. So you felt a pulling sensation?
No, it was weird. It's like the lights went out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've got my eyes closed. I remember pulling the trigger. I remember I was quick about it. I didn't hesitate. I knew I was going, you know, to do this, that this was the time.
Mm-hmm.
That was it. I didn't have any doubt about what I was doing. I wasn't conflicted.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like that. That set of mind? What do you mean, set of mind?
A mindset?
Mindset? Yeah, that. That mindset you get when you're running a really long race and you see the finish line.
Oh, yeah.
You don't really tap into how exhausted you are or emotionally how you're feeling. You've just got your eye on the goal and you're going to get there.
There we go.
For me, I had the eye on the goal. I had to get out.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the feel of the gun. I remember pulling the trigger, hearing the sound. It was darkness, and then I was looking at my body.
Hmm. That must have been freaky.
Yeah, I had no clue. I did not know that I would be able to see myself. That never even crossed my mind. I really just kind of thought that I would go into nothing. I wanted it to crumble. I wanted it to go away. I wanted to snuff it out.
So what were your emotions when you saw your body? I mean, what did you feel?
Oh, that's the face. He just kind of went blank on me, and his mouth kind of just hung slightly open, and he said that's what he felt.
His jaw dropped, that sort of thing? Like,
yeah.
What the fuck? Like that?
No, Mom, it was wild. It wasn't a what the fuck. It was more like a, oh. I didn't want to stay there. I didn't want to see everything. But I couldn't leave. It's like watching a bad car wreck.
Oh, yeah.
But I wasn't tethered to it at all. It was bizarre.
Tethered emotionally?
Yeah.
Yeah. What else did you feel?
I guess it was shock more than anything.
Did you feel euphoria or anything like that also along with it?
Quiet. It was quiet. It was... I had no pain. I didn't have any worries. And that was unsettling. Because I haven't really felt like that before, that everything was in its right place.
Mm.
So I think it was way more unsettling to me than celebratory.
Wow. But did you think it was cool to just like fly around? And that did you feel that unconditional love that a lot of people talk about?
No.
Or was that when you crossed over that you'd have to... feeling that, I guess you.
When I crossed over.
All right, well, let's talk more then. So you were looking at that, and you were sort of like, wow, and you were a little bit of shock. Did you feel a little bit of, oh, shit, what are they going to think when they find me, or?
He's real quiet. You can tell he's going through it.
Mm.
I'm telling him to take his time. He said, you know, I don't slow down to think about my death too much. To me, it was a way out. It has a lot of pain associated to it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just my pain, but my family's pain and my friends' pain.
Mm-hmm. Well, I won't make you dwell on it. Let's go to what happened what it felt like after you started getting out of your room. What? Tell me about that.
I remember seeing my body leave.
Your body leave? Oh, okay, when they were taking you away?
In the bag.
Okay, right, right.
Then I remember thinking that I needed to say goodbye.
Mm-hmm.
And if I remember right, that's when I started checking. He's saying that's when you started checking in with family members.
Okay, yeah. I remember you said that, yeah. That must have been painful because we were not happy.
He's got his elbows on his knees, his hands are clasped in kind of front of him. Very casual, but he's solemn, a little bit more solemn.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I remember finding he's tearing up.
Oh. We don't have to do this, Brammy.
He said, shut up, Mom.
Mm.
Tearing up, but not afraid to tell you to be quiet. He said, when you slow down to go back through your memories, you see more.
Yeah.
He says, you do miss a lot when you're in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
It's like your eyes aren't big enough. I know I've told you before. I'm really sorry for you. I'm really sorry for Dad and for everyone else in the family.
Yeah.
But I know there's one thing, is I cannot apologize for my happiness.
Oh, no, I'm happy for you. I wouldn't have it any other way if I had to choose between you being here and miserable, of course.
But how fucked up is it, Mom? That was my option.
Yeah. I wouldn't want that to happen.
Well, I can't seem to figure out when I go through it again. Why does it hurt so bad when the outcome was exactly what I was looking for?
And you're happy. I mean, how can it hurt when you're happy? You're just looking at the moment. The moment wasn't happy, but the result was happy. So we'll move past the moment and go to... So tell me about your crossing over. Did you feel like you were tugged? I remember you said you were tugged by your shoulders or something like that. I can't remember exactly.
Yeah, I felt like I was being pulled back. I guess I just really wasn't paying attention. It sounds like me anyways. Always looking at something I wasn't supposed to be looking at.
He was looking at something he wasn't supposed to be looking at?
He's just speaking in general.
Oh, okay.
Probably why he didn't see like a big gorgeous white light.
Oh, okay.
You know, hear the angels sing, and he's laughing. He goes, no, I was probably fucking doing something wrong, and over to the side. Probably why I got jerked.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. That feeling is unspeakable. That one is... It's like taking a body and putting it through a strainer.
Hmm.
And having all the pieces come out on the other end, but... Different.
Hmm.
Clean.
Hmm.
I suppose it would be the feeling that I think back in the old days, people thought if they got baptized by Jesus that everything would disappear and they'd only be good.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what death is.
Wow.
Mm. You really are good.
Yeah.
You're not missing those other parts. They're still with you, but they don't play a big part of the song.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You don't lose any of yourself. But what comes forward is this overwhelming sense of perfection,
mm-hmm.
being in the right place,
mm-hmm.
being loved, and you being able to feel it. Like, there's not even the tiniest comment or remark about doubting what's coming your way, or if there was some string attached, or were they trying to lure you in and really it was hell, you know?
Yeah.
None of that. It just is so much that you don't even weep about it.
Hmm.
That's where, you know, your family and your friends show up.
Yeah.
Where you notice you're not alone.
Who was the first one to meet you?
I heard him say, oh, hell, I can't even remember.
Yeah. It was Denise there. Aunt Denise, I think she was also there, right?
Yes. He remembers seeing a whole bunch of faces. And he says, it's different now looking back. I can get the feeling, I can understand the feeling much more clear rather than relying on what I was seeing and saying.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because now it's all, you know, in spirit, it's more about feelings than about mental,
yeah.
like brain type, you know, remembering details. I think that's why people say, well, what was in your pocket in your when I buried you, you know, stuff like that. It's like they don't remember things like that anymore. It's not important to them. It's all about feeling.
You're right, and trust me, we're not checking our fucking pockets either.
Exactly. All right, let's go on to life review. What's a life review like? I mean, are they, maybe they're all different for each person, but give me a general on what a life review entails.
Yeah, it's, sometimes you feel like you're going into this room, like an IMAX theater, and it's almost a 360. But you get to feel what emotions or impressions that other people perceived of you. So it's not that you're going through this life review and you get to feel what you've done for yourself. You see you through other people. That's... I can't imitate that. basically, he just said, that's totally wrong. That's really fucked up. Like,
so you
that's
see,
the worst
see,
joke you could play on anyone.
Okay, so you see, you're like that person. You're seeing through their eyes and feeling what they felt.
Yes.
Oh, boy, that's not fun. Do you feel so, those things? If on Earth you've resolved that, do you still, I mean, you've made up for them and you've said, I'm sorry, and you really, do you still have to go through that with that person?
No. No.
Okay, good.
No, if it's truly resolved, it's not on your plate. It's not what your running theme was.
Ooh, I'm going to go around and apologize to a bunch of people then.
And he said, the life review is not like somebody comes in and says, excuse me, it's time for your life review. It's at 2:30. Please walk into this room and have a seat, please. He said it just kind of overtakes you. And it's weird. It will happen really fast, but you'll feel like you've been in it forever.
Hmm. Well, what causes the life review? I mean, I don't understand. What's its origins? Who decides it? Who creates it? Who?
Most of the time, it's actually the consciousness, the human experience, the need for the human to do a checklist.
Mm-hmm.
Energetically and spiritually,
mm-hmm.
it's not really needed. You don't need to go through those checkpoints, because if you came in spiritually, energetically connected, you already know what those checkpoints are.
Okay.
you know, this is pretty much for every living person. We're functioning more from our brain than any other part.
Mm-hmm.
So it's almost like the brain decompressing, running through everything, but it's in the reverse. You get to understand how others perceived and felt for you, and your answers are given to you. Oh, that's why this happened this way. Oh, that's why. Like, you put things to rest in a very quick way.
So is it painful emotionally,
no.
Or is it, no?
Nah. It's definitely fucked up, but it's not painful. You don't leave wrecked or anything, like from Titanic, right, Mom?
So was yours very long? I mean, did you have to go through a whole lot? Didn't seem like you fucked up a lot of people.
It wasn't a whole lot. Mine was mostly the voices in my head. You know, my fucked up shit.
What do you mean?
He says, I had to deal and have conversation with myself quite a bit.
Mm.
You know, talk myself down from shit and try to understand myself. And that's mostly what I came across.
Ah. Who else did you have to deal with the most as far as your life review is concerned?
It was mostly my family.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Anything else on life review?
Nah, that's probably it.
Do you ever go through life review with past lives or anything like that too? Or just this current life when you transition?
It pretty much is a decompression of the life you were just exiting.
Okay. Now, okay, this white tunnel, this white light you hear about, of course, some people experience it, some people don't. Why do some experience it? Why do some not? And what the hell is it?
Only the good get to go down the tunnel, Mother.
Oh, it reminds me of that. Remember that movie, Outer Limits, or whatever, back in the, I don't know, 60s or something? Reminds me of that. Where these guys jump into this swirling black and white thing to, I don't know. All right.
Because, no, really, it's based on the belief system.
Okay, what is it? Does it exist even?
The tunnel of white light?
Yeah. Or yeah.
He said, here's my two cents about it. One is that if that was what you believed in, that's how you knew you were going to die and you're supposed to see this bright white light and all that crap, then I feel that's what you're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
But also, the actual death of the brain, the lack of oxygen and everything, creates this kind of tunnel vision.
Mm-hmm.
But is that the light that you go into and cross into death? No. That's your brain dying.
Okay. Okay, well, so the belief system had to start from someplace. You know, I mean, of course, the belief in God and
it started from those people who did those near-death experiences.
Oh, okay.
Where they saw their brain dying, and they got up and talked about it and saw that they saw God and angels and all this. And, you know, because consciously, thank you for saying that. This makes sense. Consciously, you're trying to look through the eyes that are set in your head.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
When the brain is dying, then that's what you're seeing.
Mm-hmm.
Intuitively, if you're looking through your third eye, you don't have to see a tunnel of white light to cross over into the beyond.
Okay.
So if you're looking with your third eye, your intuitive eye, most likely it'll be just like going into another room.
Oh. Yeah, a lot of people describe that. It's just like going into another room. Now, when you got pulled back by your shoulders, where'd you end up?
In another room.
Okay. And
it was like the room around me just kind of disappeared where I was. It just kind of dissolved. Because I think that's the only way I know how to say it.
Okay.
It got dark, dim the lights, turn the lights on, you're in a different space.
Wow.
And there was nothing fast about it. It wasn't like a quick jerk or anything. It was more of like how you feel your body going into sleep.
Okay.
It felt like that.
Oh, cool. Now, and when you were doing your life review, I remember you talking about how it was at sort of a long table, and you had your head in your hands.
Mm-hmm.
All right. We went backwards there. What were some of the adjustments you had to make when you crossed over? What were some of the most, not, I won't say difficult, the most interesting, the most, you know, intense?
How to move.
How to move, yeah. Hmm. Okay, I can't feel my legs. Like a major pain. That's because they ain't there.
I have no idea what you're talking about, but he's almost on the floor.
Because we watched Major Pain, you know, that was, I don't know, one of the Wayans brothers. It was so funny. Okay.
Yeah, I guess similar to that.
Okay.
But it's just interesting, though. I'd say that was the most urgent one that you come across.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how to get from here to there. And it's weird because you keep moving and traveling, yet you can't explain to yourself how you're doing it.
Oh,
it keeps happening. And you're like, oh shit, it's happening.
What, was it scary?
You don't know how.
Is it kind of scary for you?
No. No, I wasn't afraid. But I definitely wasn't getting all the answers that I needed ASAP. That was weird.
Was there some sort of guide that was there for you during or after your life review, after death? Anybody to help you?
If there was, that dick must have been hiding behind the curtain because I didn't see anyone.
Oh my God, that's awful. How come? Is it because you didn't ask for help?
Oh, well, I definitely didn't ask for help. And I think really I just wanted to be alone.
Do you think if you asked for help, they would
come?
Oh, yeah.
With bells ringing.
Why did you want to be alone?
Because I wanted rest.
Okay. Was part of it shame? You thought you would get in trouble for doing what you did?
He says, wow, that's interesting.
Like, ooh, I'm busted. Don't take me to hell.
No.
Okay. That's good.
No, I never felt like that. How cool is that?
That's awesome. So you couldn't move. You tell me about the whole learning experience of learning how to move.
Well, it's like I couldn't consciously get myself to go, but if I thought about being somewhere, I'd end up there.
Mm-hmm.
So it kept happening, but I couldn't figure out how exactly it was happening.
But, you know, could you see your arms and legs? Or were you just consciousness? Could you see your spirit body?
Yeah, that's mostly what you see. You don't see yourself as you were as a human.
Okay, and so it wasn't just like you were seeing the environment, but you were just an awareness without a body.
Yeah, without a body, without a human body.
Without a human
I had
body.
Energetic shape. You know, I was light, and I felt like myself. I knew my whereabouts. You know, I knew what happened. It's not like I was thrown into some strange world without a map. Like, I felt like I belonged and I was safe. I was never afraid, but it was just like the small things like that that would just kind of fuck you in the head a little bit.
Mm-hmm. But you looked down, you could see a leg, your legs, your feet, and all that, right? But it wasn't a human body, but you could see it as, I mean, you weren't just like a ball of light.
Correct, yeah, right,
okay,
right. Yeah,
got it.
Had an energetic shape.
And you could move, you could look at your hand and make a fist and things like that. It was just more about moving from one place to another, like going to Norway to visit your grandfather or anything like that.
Yeah.
So you learn how to think it and then be there.
Yeah.
Okay, what were some other adjustments that you had to make when you crossed over?
Well, I was used to kind of arguing with myself in my head.
Mm-hmm.
Or having contradicting thoughts and emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And that shit just doesn't happen.
Hmm.
That was weird.
What happens instead?
Because I don't really know how to explain it. You just, you don't have them. You can't be angry and happy.
Okay, so it's just more peace. No conflict in your head.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
How old were you when the last time, when you were in that place the last time? I mean, the last time you were in that space.
I had moments of it, but never consistency.
Okay, I don't think anybody has it consistently.
Really?
Where they're always, always, always at peace with no conflict in their head? Of course not.
Come on, there's got to be people. Isn't that what being happy is?
I mean, 100%?
Yeah, Eric, there's...
Come on, what if somebody is super constipated and they're sitting there on the toilet and they can't pinch one off? That is not a happy situation.
Yeah, but that's a physical conflict.
Well, it doesn't make any difference. That's going to make an emotional conflict. It's going to make an emotional conflict. So, no, nobody's totally at peace unless you're Dalai Lama or whatever.
He tells me that you have an issue with shit then.
You and your scatological humor, I don't... What other... let's move on. What are some other adjustments you had to make? Any others?
Those are the two main ones.
Okay, what about... Oh, yeah, when did you ask for help? At what point did you finally say, I need help?
When I wanted to get back to my family and I didn't know how.
Oh, did you miss us?
Yeah.
And so, who appeared?
This was a female guide,
mm-hmm.
Not his aunt. This is someone who was telling him how to cross dimensions and how to communicate. And he says, about this time is when you were doing all the research and trying to find mediums. You know, so mm-hmm. I was learning how to talk to them and get into it. By then, you know, I didn't have any conflict with my emotions. I was perfectly A-okay.
Yeah.
I knew how to travel, and then I just immediately started learning how to communicate to humans.
Okay.
Cross-dimensional communication.
So how did you ask? Did you just think, I need help? Or
yeah.
Did you get on a loudspeaker and say, hey, anybody, step up to the plate?
No, I just thought about it. You know, I would need someone to come teach me how to do this, and then that's all you do.
Now, did you have to go through any kind of, they say some people have to go through some sort of therapy, you know, to mend energetically, et cetera. Did you go through that process, too?
I did some, yes.
Yeah. Probably, they say, somebody said, I don't know, it was through Kim O'Neill, that you had to go through a lot less than most suicides.
Yeah.
For some reason. Why is that?
It was contract written that this was, you know, the end of my line. Whereas most times, people who are doing suicide, it's not the end of their line. They're doing it as a revenge or an out or avoidance.
Okay. It's not their destiny. It's not an exit point.
Right.
All right. Now, what do most spirits miss about the earthly plane? I know you probably have your buddies over there that they like, oh, my God, you know, I really miss pizza, whatever. You know, I really miss taste. Or, you know, what do most, if you did a survey, miss about the earthly plane?
Food, number one. Sex, number two.
But I thought the sex was better over there.
It is, but it's not physical like that. It's different, so different.
Okay. And food, why do you miss food? Can't you conjure up that whole taste thing, or is it different? The texture?
Sure.
Can you create
totally
that?
Different.
Can you create that taste, that the fullness in your belly, the texture? Can't you create that?
Like the whole chewing it, smelling it, waiting for it to be done. I mean, we don't really have that kind of process. We don't need it.
Yeah, but can't you think it and create every aspect of that?
It's not the same, Mom.
It's just not the same.
It's like artificial flavoring is not the same as real flavor.
Ah, I see. All right. Okay, and sex is not quite, you don't have that physical, all right, physical body to enjoy sex.
He's talking about the banging.
Oh, God. Erik. But you didn't have much of it when you were here. So you're going to have to come back as a prostitute. or what do you call it? A gigolo. Come back as a gigolo.
He definitely, if he said he had to come back, he's definitely coming back with a dick.
Okay, so you come back as a gigolo. So you can really get some. On a regular basis.
He just sounded out. Jamie has just checked out.
Okay, now, let's talk about what do you think that when spirits come back, when spirits cross back over, what do they say? Oh my God, I missed this about heaven. Oh, I'm so glad to be back because now, whatever. What have they missed about heaven?
When spirits leave.
And then they come back and say, oh my God, I'm finally back in heaven. I've missed such and such.
So he's talking about the bullshit.
Missed the bullshit? Or missed getting away from the bullshit? Of course. I know the answer.
The emotional conflict.
So they miss getting away from the emotional conflict.
That's why a lot of people like to come to Earth, to feel the lower vibrational emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Hardship, struggle.
But when they come back to heaven, they come back saying, oh God, I miss getting away from the emotional conflict. That's what
is that said right? Does that make sense? Because the way he's explaining it is, they're attracted to it, so that's why you reincarnate, because that's where some of the deeper lessons are learned,
mm-hmm.
is through the conflict, because there's not really conflict in heaven or home.
Mm-hmm.
So when the human dies and comes a spirit, the ease of life is sometimes shocking and hard to adjust to,
mm-hmm.
because they just spent all that time adjusting to conflict.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so he's saying that it's not that they miss that the most. He says it's just what's the hardest to adapt to.
To not having it anymore? No, I want to know what they miss about heaven when they come in. Oh my God, I'm glad to be back because I missed.
Glad to be back on Earth or glad to
no,
be back?
No, back in heaven.
Oh, the ease of life. Peace and love.
Oh, okay.
Unconditional love.
All right. What are the coolest new abilities? I got two more questions we can squeeze in. What are some of the coolest new abilities you gained that you didn't have on Earth?
Coolest, newest abilities that aren't raunchy.
Really? I didn't expect that we could go there on this question, but leave it to
Erik.
Telepathy, okay.
Love it. It's accurate. It's better than instant message. It's better than text. It's better than email.
Mm. Okay. What else?
Not being stuck on planet Earth.
Mm.
You could just go wherever the F you want to go.
Now, why are you saying F? Really, Jamie? Seriously?
I know. You can just go wherever you fucking want to go.
Okay, there we go. He's got you all messed up today, I swear.
Wow, the highs and the lows that we've gone through already.
I swear to God. I know, this is an emotional roller coaster day. Okay, anything? What else? I can imagine, look at the frequent flyer miles you can rack up over there.
Yeah, that, love that.
What else? Name a couple of more.
Oh, he said it's a couple more, really, transcending space and time.
Okay, ooh.
Time travel? Going back into your past lives? Mm. Oh, what about going to the fucking library?
The Akashic Records?
Yeah, that shit fucking blows your mind.
Tell me about it.
I can't even plan how to get to the grocery store and buy everything that I need. And I go into here, and all my past lives, future lives, my now lives, my afterlife lives are all finely tuned. How the fuck does that happen?
Wow, so what do you go into, like a library and open up a book? And what is it like?
It's not really like a book. It's more like a ever-ending page. Like, it's not like a lick-flip book.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of like a scroll, in a way. Like, one constant page. But, like, you don't have to manually hand-roll shit. It just comes, the information comes to you.
Is it like a hologram, like a
hands-up
display or something?
Kind of like that, yeah. Think kind of technologically advanced.
And what, you could take your thumb and just, like an iPhone, and just scroll through it? Or does it, you sync it and it goes to the next? You think about going to this life or that life or whatever, and how does it work?
It shows you.
Well, interesting. Is it cool colors, glowing, sparkly?
Oh my God, yeah, because to me I see it kind of glowing in a blue color.
Hmm, I can almost see it. Probably have. Okay, last question. What source of energy should we be using? If the environmentalists are, I know this is on a completely different topic, if the environmentalists are against natural gas and oil, etc., I mean, it's too early. I mean, we're not there with solar energy yet, wind energy. What should we be using?
He says, we got to be there. He says, actually, we are there with solar.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't want to fucking spend the money.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's expensive.
That's kind of stupid.
That we don't want to spend the money?
Yeah, because
some people don't have some people don't have the money. I mean, it takes money to put those photo cells up on your roof. Or roof, whatever.
He's barking like a dog, by the way.
Oh, Jesus.
It's not just the photo cells, it's how they're turned. You know, the ones that mimic photosynthesis of the leaves?
Mm-hmm.
The degrees of why the leaves turn down and how they adjust.
Mm-hmm.
That's the money, man.
Yeah.
You don't even have to live in a bright place.
Yeah.
You know, you just have to have it positioned accurately.
Well, it just will store everything in batteries anyway, but you know, some people just can't afford that, Eric.
Well, you can shit on your own government for that one, because they are the ones who should be restructuring the communities and the grid systems to have natural power.
Well, you know, they're too busy giving foreign aid to France and Pakistan and all that, so, you know.
Wouldn't it be great if we just took care of ourselves first?
I know. Exactly. Well, eventually we'll tap into the zero-point field where there's endless energy, but I don't see that happening anytime soon. Will
no.
it?
No.
We're talking hundreds and hundreds of years, or we're talking less than that?
Less than that.
Oh, good. How long? Más o menos.
We'll have the shit figured out probably in about the 90-year mark.
Okay. I think they're already starting to work on it, so that's good. All right.
And we're talking about the world, right? Getting the world all situated?
Well, I don't know.
Situated.
Yeah, I
guess. Get it situated?
Situated. But, let's talk about the United States first. Will that be quicker? And then the rest of the world will learn from us?
Correct the mundo.
All right. I guess that's it. Bye. Toodles, everybody. I have that marketing. Well, you saw that. Marketing meeting at 11, so I'm going to bring up how you can. Did you just email some questions if you have any, okay?
Do I need questions?
No. If you want to, you don't have to ask any questions.
Because I, you know, I don't feel like I have any.
Right,
it's extremely thorough in it.
Okay, just if you have any. And so you like the book cover? It's pretty cool, huh?
Yeah, they did a good job on that.
I know. Blue is my favorite color, too. It's so peaceful.
And it matches the web, too.
Oh, yeah. That's right. They meant to do that.
Good.
All right to you. I'll talk to you later. Hi, Erik. I love you.
Love you, Mom.
Love you. Crazy boy.
He said thank you.
All over the map today. See you later, guys. Love you, Jamie.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.